Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and podding alongside me this week, as usual, are George Cran.
Hello.
Graham Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
And we've got a special guest, late substitute for the too busy Alan Temple. It's none other. That's the same
easy
as none other
say.
Than the boss, Sean Hamilton. George is sitting up straight and everything. Bear and I don't care,
behaviors.
We've retired.
I know. The boss, that's Bruce Springsteen.
You play guitar.
Well,
you do?
Yeah. I know you're right, actually. I shouldn't do myself down.
No, you are the boss. Yeah. What am I going to call you? Would you want to be called head of sport?
Depends what else is going on.
If it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Well, you're
Sean's fine.
Okay, Sean.
Right.
You're here to give your expertise about everything. You know everything.
I don't. Not at all.
So we'll start with you.
Actually, no, surprisingly little.
Well, that never stopped me. Anyway, the real ball comes out on Saturday, boys. And Dundee United are at Spartans. And does anybody want to say the name of the cup? I just call it the League Cup.
It's the Viaplay, isn't it?
Yeah.
Is it the Viaplay Cup?
Is it just the Viaplay
yeah.
Cup?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which I've got just now because I got it for the Scotland game.
Are you paying for it?
You're the one.
I think it runs out before Dundee's televised games, so they'll need to start well. But United aren't on TV, but important game for them. It's been a difficult summer, Sean.
Mm.
They'll want to start well.
Oh, of course, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, United in whatever the circumstances. I mean, if you're going away to Spartans, you're expecting to win. That's it. Regardless of anything else, you are the favourites. So there's pressure on them in that sense. There always would be under those circumstances. But I guess, given that you've gone down. And you didn't expect to go down. Puts a little extra layer on top of it. Because they want to turn up and kind of set a standard early doors, you know.
Yeah.
So, there'll be a lot of eyes on them. And, you know, if they stumble in that first game, immediately you've got questions to answer and the pressure just ramps up enormously. So, yeah, it's a big one for them. Have they had a bad summer? I don't think they have.
It's a difficult summer.
Difficult, nope. Right. Okay.
Has been. I mean,
nobody's still really seen it though. That's the
difficult summer behind closed doors.
Yeah.
Mm. Which the feedback has been positive about the actual games, but the fact is, bring you in here, Bear. They're still rebuilding their team. They've made two signings this week. Look very good signings, but they are being thrown in. Quicker than any manager would want to.
Yeah, definitely. And they're going to be rebuilding their team, I would suggest, certainly to the end of the transfer window and possibly beyond the transfer window, because you can
loans
bring in...
and free agents.
Free agents, of course.
Yeah, there's always a plethora of guys that get released at the end of August.
Yeah, it is an ongoing process. And even though they've played a couple of games behind closed doors, it's going to be... I would think a few months before we'll actually see the real United team, and that could be a concern for Dundee United, because by that point we will be into league fixtures, which of course that is United's main objective this season, to get themselves back into that Premier League. But a good one on Saturday. I think the fans will be delighted to finally go and see their team. Everybody else, Dundee have had games, all the other teams have seemed to have had games where the fans have been able to get in and see a game.
I have to say that this would have been my dream pre-season. I never liked pre-season friendlies.
Couldn't get in to see them, but you would have had to go.
But I am an exception.
I mean, Alan Temple's done his best to climb above hedges and that and cover games, so you would have had to do exactly the same thing to him. But it's good to see the real ball coming out. You're right on Saturday, and it'll be interesting to see what Jim Goodwin's first starting lineup actually is. He's brought in a goalkeeper this week. We don't know too much about him, Jack Walton, and another
good girl. Pedigree.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's telling that. Well, we know Jim Goodwin is going to be bringing more players in. He has moved very quickly to bring a goalkeeper in. I think that's telling, in as much as that Mark Barighetti, while he's still got another year to go at the club, I'd be surprised if Mark Barighetti's actually in the goal on Saturday. I think Watton will come straight into the team. And that may in turn put pressure on Barighetti, and as much as, you know, to basically realise that his days at Dundee United will be numbered, you would suggest, in terms of match action.
Yeah.
He could hang on for as long as he wants. He's got a year on his contract. He could stay at United. But you know, maybe putting a bit of pressure on him there by bringing that goalkeeper in. So, I'm not surprised to see he has signed the goalkeeper, and it's important that he gets off to a good start. And I know that there is pressure in these sort of League Cup games. You know, there is pressure for the big team, and Dundee United are the big team in the section to get through. It is more important that United start putting a team together on the park. Hopefully they'll still manage to qualify from that. Mm-hmm. But what I would say is, let's not put too much pressure on the manager here straight off the bat, because, you know, he's got enough on his plate, you know, getting a squad together and being prepared for that championship. But I'm glad it's starting anyway, Tom. We can look forward to that on Saturday.
George, just to pick up on something Bear said there, and I mean, I hate to disagree with Bear, so I'm going to let you do it. He said that puts the arrival of Jack Walton puts pressure on Barighetti. Does it not finish him? I mean, I've nothing against Barighetti. He's another one that had a fine pedigree, but the fact of the matter is he did not have a good season last season. Could that be the end of him? I mean, we'll come to Aziz Behic, who might not be seen again, fellow countryman. Jim Goodwin made the point about him. It's a long, long way from home. If Barighetti's not playing, he might want to get back to Australia.
Yeah, I think it's a clear signal from the manager, isn't it? The good thing about having Goodwin in towards the end of last season, although it didn't work in terms of keeping United up, he got to have a good look behind the scenes and see where the problems are. And it seems like his initial signings have all been about fixing those big problems. And I think one of them was the goalkeeper. I mean, we could see every manager, I think, or certainly Liam Fox and Jim Goodwin at one point kind of gave up patience with Barighetti because there was just too many errors. I can't see a way back. The issue is who signs him? That's the thing after the season he's had.
Well, certainly, I mean, anybody who's watching him weekly here,
that's
going to have a hard time justifying shelling out.
But then Australia is
down under, is
exactly.
It?
And also, I mean, I suppose it sounds a wee bit daft to say that fans in Australia, they maybe won't have seen, because the global media is global and you see everything everywhere. You can if you go looking for it. But, you know, I doubt that there will be, you know, kind of compilations of Mark Barighetti howlers on Australian television, for instance, and things like that. So
And if there was a story in Australia about Dundee United with the World Cup last season, and it was going to be Behic, you would think that was the focus of that. And he does seem to have a good reputation there. So, I mean, you'd hope for his sake, if this is the end of his time at United, he would get a move back home or wherever he wants to. But I just think Jack Walton, maybe not first choice at Luton, but had been on the bench a lot. He's not coming to the Scottish Championship to be on the bench. No, he could be sitting on the bench in the English Premiership.
Well, they wouldn't be happy. Luton wouldn't send
him. No, it's part of his development as well, isn't it? So I've got to say, I completely went
over my head when Jack Walton signed and he was coming up on loan from Luton, that Luton were actually a Premier League club.
You
start to realise, and you're right enough, you know, he's coming up here to take the gloves. There's no doubt about that. It could depend on whether, I mean, Mark Barighetti's obviously turned up, which he's had to do for pre-season training. It'll be part of his contract. He'll be getting a wage. It'll depend on, as you said, Tom, his stock will still be quite high, I would imagine, in Australia. Yeah. Any goalkeeper can have a bad season.
Yeah.
It's whether he can get himself a contract that is lucrative enough to price him away from Dundee United at this point in time.
Did you have any bad seasons?
Oh, I'm teen. maybe not seasons, but, you know, I was thinking about that, you know, the other day. I was fortunate. I played at a time when teams didn't actually carry substitute goalkeepers. So, you know, everybody has bad spells, but you just had to play through them. Fortunately, they didn't go on for long enough that the manager said, we're going to have to sign another keeper and you're going.
We need to send you to Australia.
Yeah, no, absolutely. But yeah, I think that's the thing. I think that's what it's going to boil down to ultimately. Who's going to give Mark Birigiti a contract that's comparable or gets as near to the one he's got at Dundee United at this point in time?
I mean, the one problem for him might be modern managers. We've seen it across the road at Dens. I think it was last week that Tony Docherty said, I want three goalkeepers competing. And Jim Goodwin might say, well, I don't have to look for an experienced backup because I've got one there, so just keep him. And then he's got his three goalkeepers. If Birigiti goes, you would imagine United would be in the market for another goalie.
I think maybe with the way finances are coming from the Premiership down to the Championship, they might be quite happy with just the two, I think, because you can use that money elsewhere.
You've also got emergency loans at that level, I suppose, as well. But it's
Jan Heumann's an up-and-coming goalkeeper. Yes. They like him a lot, so...
Aye, well, I get that was what was crossing my mind there is if he lets Birigiti go, he's maybe trying to bring someone in who might be third choice. And how do you persuade someone to sign when they're going to be third choice?
It's not an easy sell.
I mean, time will tell. And as George says, the financial situation means if I would imagine Birigiti's on a decent wage because he's an experienced player. And if he's going to. If he wants to go, I would think United probably would let him go home. Mm-hmm. We should probably mention the other signing because that seems to have ramifications. Ollie Denham from Cardiff City seems to have paved the way for Charlie Mulgrew to go if he wants.
I don't think that'll come as a surprise to many Dundee United fans as well. I mean, Charlie Mulgrew has been a fantastic player throughout his career, an experienced player. He's played at the highest level, he's played at international level, but he is, I think he's 37 years old.
Yeah.
And there's no getting away from the fact that you simply can't cover the ground at 37 the way you did at 27. So Jim Goodwin's looked at, again, Charlie Mulgrew will be on a big wage. Mm-hmm. And therein lies a problem when you're 37. Yeah. Who else is coming looking for a 37-year-old defender? Well, it could depend on what Charlie's got on offer elsewhere. Mm-hmm.
It depends about you, how you want your team to play as well, if you're a coach. Because, I mean, I don't know what Jim Goodwin wants Dundee, how he wants them to approach matches in the Championship, because we've not seen them, neither has anybody else. But, you know, if you're a club of the stature of Dundee United in the Championship, you're wanting to be on the front foot, you're wanting to be controlling games, you know. And in that case, your centre-halves, where are they going to be sat on the pitch?
Yeah.
You're expecting them to be up towards the halfway line and controlling the game. So there's a lot of space in behind you. Mm-hmm. So if a team's going to break on you and you're 37, are you going to have the legs to get back and cover that break? Don't think so. So I think that under those circumstances, that might make it difficult for Charlie Mulgrew to play at Dundee United this season.
But then he gives you that quality in the ball.
He does, that's absolutely.
Difference. But maybe
you know
Jim
from watching it, Bear knows from watching a lot of Championship.
Exactly, I was just going to say that.
Long and painful Dundee supporting career. You can, if you've got two centre halves that defend really well, you can leave, and you're the team that's chasing the title. You can leave them back and they defend. Yeah. I always think
me talking about centre half sitting on the halfway line. I'm forgetting we're not talking Champions League here.
But I mean, one of the things I admire greatly about Lee Ashcroft at Dundee is when he gets the ball, he looks for the simple pass. Mm. And you can let other players do the creative stuff. Now, Charlie Mulgrew does the creative stuff. Is it needed? Also crosses my mind, if Jim Goodwin's looking at Charlie Mulgrew as a squad player, A, at 37, you don't want to be sitting on the bench, and B, at 37, can you sit on the bench for five, six weeks at a time and then suddenly come in and be match sharp. Really, you need to keep yourself going.
Can you
going.
Sit on the bench for 45 minutes and then go to the park?
There's a lot of players his age would have to stand in the technical area.
That's why Saturday's lineup is going to be really interesting to him, to see if he does bring these two new lads in straight away, if it's a new look, effectively, defensive setup. You know, Kevin Holt's going to be there, you know, as well. It could be a completely new lineup we're looking at here, but I'll give you an indication. I think of where Jim Goodwin is going with his Dundee United team.
He's got to use these games to an extent to get his new partnerships, not just in central defence, but all over the pitch. Mm-hmm. And I mean, get the defence used to the goalkeeper, get the midfield used to each other. So you tend to think it'll be, the new players will all be involved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, that's, we have this discussion every season at this point. Since the League Cup's changed format, you know, every manager's given it, oh, no, we're taking this very seriously and we want to win this tournament and we're not treating it like a friendly. But to an extent, every manager kind of has to an extent. Because there's just not enough time otherwise. So you're inevitably, there's some degree of experimentation still going on when you get to the tournament.
Yeah, it's the truth. Not basically the Premier League clubs and the clubs at the top end of the Championship treat the groups with hope.
Mm.
Yeah. And if they get through the groups, they treat it seriously because they've got to get their team together.
It's like, well, we should have enough to get through this, even if we're messing about a bit.
There's a backstory that you know, the big clubs are under pressure to get through, and Jim Goodwin is under real pressure to get off to a good start, and that's the conundrum he's got. While he can treat it, you know, he wants to get his team ready for the Championship. He can't afford to take his eye off the ball and have a slip, you know, against Spartans or against one of the other winners, because the fans will be on his case instantly.
No, there's no leeway at all.
No, there's not. So, yeah.
Likewise, is Jim Goodwin, he always strikes me as a strong character. He's got that strength of character. I mean, he took the United job at a time when, after what happened at Aberdeen, he would have been forgiven for a want of break, but he wanted right back in. Mm-hmm. He was like that as a player. Will his mindset be, we want to qualify, we want to go as far as possible in the competition, make a bit of money. But he'll also have in the back of his mind that if United win their first four league games, nobody's really going to worry too much if they've struggled a bit over the Via Play Cup sections.
That's true. I mean, when you're in the Championship, and obviously your priority is the league, it always is, but I mean, if you're doing all right in the league and you're in that position, the cup's a wee bit of extra excitement. It can add to your sort of good vibe around the place. Mm-hmm. If you're streaking ahead in the league and you're also having good results in the cup as well, it just builds and creates a good feeling. But it feels like a bonus. It feels like it's not essential for all that every manager will give it. They'll pay lip service to taking it very seriously. Okay, I think you have to say that. But if you United certainly will want to be getting through this group stage 100%, definitely. But if they don't, as long as they do all right in the league, it's not the end of the world.
What I'm saying is, if they don't get through, can you imagine the pressure that Jim Goodwin's going to be under at Gayfield, the first league game of the season?
Yeah. I'm just thinking, to be brutally honest about it, is the problem for managers with the Viaplay Cup people like us? Because it's not all our fault, but the pressure comes from, it's a good statistic if things are going wrong. Yeah. I mean, nobody really says, well, that's them won eight games in a row, because if four of them were in the Viaplay Cup against part-time opposition.
I say that. I said that last season about Dundee.
But if it goes the other way, those games are added on, you know, to the bad run statistic. And that's when pressure comes.
Dundee United's problem is the conversation we just had.
I've forgotten already.
I maybe got caught up there. But no, what it is like we all talk about that, like the way that we build it up. Like, oh, there's pressure here. Oh, there's this, there's that. We're putting the pressure on by even having that conversation.
Yeah, I suppose.
But I always see the group stage, certainly for clubs like United, as an opportunity to get the season off on a good start, because you're playing against lower league teams, mm-hmm. generally the favourite. You should be scoring goals and getting wins on the board and a bit of momentum for the season to come. And I think it's a decent group for United, to be honest.
I was going to say, the big, and I'm sure Jim Goodwin's thinking about this as well. The big plus for United is if they can go and beat Thistle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
a good result against Thistle, a good performance against Thistle sends a message out to the Championship.
And I don't see Partick Thistle being the same Partick Thistle we saw at the end of last season, because obviously they've lost their key players, including one to United, which helps. They're certainly rebuilding.
I think you'll find it's two.
Two?
Don't you read your own notes?
Oh, I don't read my own notes. I'm forgetting. Yeah. It is two. And they've obviously lost Tiffany and Turner.
The Dockers, yeah.
Yes.
That's the two. I knew that.
They've lost quite a few players. They are certainly on a rebuild. Spartans are the newest team in the SPFL. They will be on a high, but United should be beating them. Peterhead have been really struggling last season. And Falkirk, we have no idea what Falkirk
So we're
is
ramping even so more pressure on United. Is that what you're saying?
No, but I see it as...
in a positive way.
I see it as an opportunity.
I must admit, I look at it.
Get wins on the book.
Having realised there was two... Partick Thistle... Ross Docherty was a driving force for them.
Yeah.
Now, having seen a few Partick Thistle games last season, albeit on TV, and I'm thinking particularly the first leg of their playoff against Queen's Park, there were often times in games that they had to dig in. I never saw a game where Partick dominated for 90 minutes. Kevin Holt was a big player for them then. At the back, his experience when they got through the spell in the games where other teams were on top. So, having gone from being worried about United, I'm calling for them to destroy the Jags' promotion hopes before the league even starts.
I've got to say, I was very impressed with what Chris Doolan did coming in, taking over from Ian McCall. And, you know, I wouldn't be surprised to see I'm not saying Partick are going to be fantastic, because you can't take that many good players out of a team and expect them to perform at the same level. But I wouldn't be surprised to see Chris Doolan put a team on the park that will be competitive next season in that league. But again, it's the same as at Dundee United. Chris Doolan will be putting a team together through this group stage and trying to find out where they are at this point in time. The good thing is it's competitive football, Tom. We see the friendlies. I've been to a few already this season where things become disjointed because they make so many substitutions, managers, because they want to get minutes into players' legs, and they're not fantastic games. These are real games. Uh-huh. These are real competitive games, and you're going to see actual real tackles going in these games as well. So, yeah, we'll see what United are made of on Saturday.
I was just at a friendly with St Johnstone in East Fife, but St Johnstone changed, the entire outfield team changed at half-time. Mm. That was 10 subs. Yeah. Goalie was the only one that's the same.
Feel sorry for the boy in the tannoy.
Feel sorry for the boy in the press box who's got to send over the subs and watch the game at the same time. That's just a selfish point of view, George.
We don't have to do that anymore.
George, you did the Dundee game at Brechin. Did you not just do the Dundee team for the first hour and then put the Dundee team for the second for the last half of that?
Just didn't do the team.
To go back to a point Bear made about this is a team in sort of that's under construction. The other thing about United, you're drawn to the names and the new signings. But with Tony Watt injured, who's up front? I cannot hazard the guess.
Big question. I'll be interesting to see. I mean, he does have a few of the young lads. He's got Rory McLeod. Is he going to start off with him? He's got Glenn Middleton, obviously. I'm a big admirer of Glenn Middleton. I think he can be a real plus for United, certainly in that championship. But how does he? There isn't much weight there. So how is he going to set up? How is he going to get players forward? You know, the wide area is going to be very important for Dundee United. They have a few youngsters, Meekinson, Chris Mochrie, you know, a few young lads that are coming through as well who could be involved. But there isn't a spearhead, a figurehead.
Yeah, and he said just the other day that he's looking for an experienced striker in the Stephen Fletcher mould, which I have to admit put me in mind of a story Alex Smith told us one day when he was at the United manager. I can't remember, he was the Stenhouse Muir or something like that, was in his early managerial career, and he bumped into the great Jock Steen at a midweek game that they were both just watching, and he said Steen was like, "How you getting on, son? How you doing? Do you need any help? Blah 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 and all that." And Alec told the story against himself. Said, "Well, you know what, Jock, I'm looking for a midfielder." And Steen said, what type of midfielder? He said, well, I'm really looking for someone who can defend in his own box, get up the park for 90 minutes and support the forwards and score a few goals. And Jock Steen said, son, if I knew that midfielder, I'd be signing him. no recommending him with you. And it, I mean, replacing Stephen Fletcher is it's a big ask, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, it is. I think back to last season. It's not that long ago. But, I mean, particularly when you think about what the championships, what it can be like in terms of being athletic and get the ball forward and what have you. It would suit him as a game because he wins everything in the air, absolutely everything. And the ball tends to stick to him as well. So a Stephen Fletcher type striker would be really, really useful for Dundee United.
How do you find one, though?
That's the problem. But yeah, he would have been pretty useful this season. But, you know, if you've gone down, your revenue goes down. He's a luxury.
Oh yeah,
a luxury. Right.
I think Dundee United will find that type of player.
Yeah.
But it may not be for another 5 or 6 weeks yet. That's the problem they've got. You know, so.
Well, there'll be so many players just hanging on and hanging on as well because they know that the window doesn't shut till the end of August. So there'll be certain players who will sign deals early in the window because they've had a really good offer and they're happy with it and will take that. But there'll be other guys who are like hedging their bets and they're waiting to see what happens because it's like dominoes. When one goes, another bunch will follow. And that hasn't quite happened yet this window, I don't think. So, but once things start moving, there will be guys who then will become probably, you know, more, what's the word I'm looking for? More viable targets, if you like. But we're not quite there yet.
Mm-hmm. And to be fair to Jim Goodwin, he's gone about it the way the book says to go about it when you're having to rebuild your team. He's identified United were missing, if you like, the dogs of war in the middle of the park. He's done that with Doherty, and now he appears to have sorted his defence. And that's the sensible thing to do, because he, in the end, keep a clean sheet. Hopefully you get one goal. And you've won on Saturday, and it's solid. And the thing about trying to replace Stephen Fletcher, often in those instances where you lose a big player, it then becomes a jigsaw, does it not? You maybe get an experienced striker that can hold the ball. To blow my own trumpet slightly here, I noticed the other night, Declan Glass, playing in an advanced midfield role, got rave reviews for his performance in the friendly against Motherwell. That adds the creativity. So it might be that it's more than one player that is used to fill the void that's left by Fletcher's departure.
Yeah, it's like I say, you're not got a figurehead, so you're looking for other players to suddenly weigh in from different areas. I mean, we talked about a few of them, Declan Glass, Meekison, Rory McLeod. Maybe Logan Chalmers coming back into the team. It's a big season for him if he can finally find his, a real bit of form at Dundee United, a consistent bit of form. He can be a big player for them. But others will have to weigh in at this point in time. But maybe the case that Rory McLeod scores 4 goals on Saturday up top and suddenly the problem is solved.
Is that one of the pluses of having the young talent that United have? These kids aren't 28, 29, 30 going, Spartans. Where's the big stands? And these kids are playing for places, playing for their futures. They're hungry. Every game's a challenge to them. And one thing we know about these kids, if they rise to the challenge and reach the levels they're capable of, they're very, very good players. I mean, United's problem come January might be clubs coming in for those kids because they're doing so well.
Yeah.
And thinking about it, we're talking about, you know, Fletchers and big players and this and that, but there comes a point with young players where it has to be their season. This has to be the one.
Yeah,
maybe for these guys,
Chalmers, Glass,
and whatever, you know, what'll happen is you'll just get your opportunity and that'll be the season for you. So it could easily be that the solutions to these issues that we're talking about, they're right there, but we just haven't seen them yet. There has to be a season where these guys step up and either kick on and become sort of thought of as senior players and become subject to interest from elsewhere and whatever, or they just don't. And yeah, we're probably getting to that stage with a couple of those ones.
It's you go from playing half the games to really you want to be a starter.
Yeah,
when you're fit and your form should dictate that you are. And I've also, I mean, I don't think it's from what we hear, it's not going to happen for these group stage games. But Tony Watt's not too far away, so you hope. But there has to be the chance with him as well that someone will come in and he'll be allowed to go too.
That could well happen. And I said that on previous podcasts. Will we see Tony Watt in a Dundee United shirt again? You know, we just don't know. He seems up for the challenge, certainly, the way he's spoken. You know, and what a player to have. And we're talking here like Dundee United have major problems. Wait a minute. You know, if you look at Dundee United's squad...
They have major assets, too.
Exactly. In that championship, they've got a bloody decent squad compared to some of the teams that are in there. You know, so they've still got a squad that is going to be competitive. They just need to find a few players in the right areas. They might have got one in the goalkeeper in Jack Walton. We've really got to see him. Hopefully he can get off to a decent start. If they can find a striker, you know, the other holes are pretty much full, Tom, I would say, you know, in that team. And, you know, if you looked at Dundee United's squad... There's multiple managers in that championship would go, I would take a few of their players.
I was about to say, this is the episode of twa teams where the United fans go, well, they're so negative. And any listening championship manager goes, they've got problems with that squad.
It's a bit like that, isn't it? But, you know, you've got to be positive, and hopefully United can, although the League Cup should be used pretty much, and I've said this for Jim Goodwin, to get a team on the park that can show it's going to be competitive at the top end of the championship, so it's going to hopefully win the championship. You know, it's important, I think, that they do get off to a good start. And so, you know, beating Spartans on Saturday would be the right way to go about it.
Beat Spartans, beat Thistle, and the rest will take care of itself.
That could well do.